I'm Victoria Mullen, and I am here with
Pamela Benjamin.
You're not from around here.
I am not from around here. No, I am from, I was born in New Zealand. I'm not going to tell you how long ago. As a friend of mine says, last century, but you know, this is true. So I was born there in Dunedin, which is a very Scottish area of New Zealand. And we moved back to my parents' hometown, which is about 30 miles out of Bluff. It's out of Invercargill, between Invercargill and Bluff, right down the very bottom of New Zealand, of the South Island. And we lived there until I was seven. And my father was the son of the bicycle repairman. He lived behind the bicycle repair shop in the main street when he was a child. And my mother's father owned most of the town, including the bicycle repair shop. So my mother was the princess on the hill, and my father was the poor boy in the main street. And they were besotted with each other. And so, and then my father began to work for my grandfather, who ran a jewelry store, and he traveled all over New Zealand selling jewelry and clocks and such. And then when I was seven, we moved to Auckland because my mother was not well and she needed more professional care than you could get in the South Island. So we drove all the way up to the North Island, and my father set up his own business there as a wholesale jeweler.
Great. And then how did you end up here in Grand Rapids?
Well, it was by default. When I was 25, I decided to travel by ship to Australia. On my way to traveling to Canada to visit my brother, who had moved there. But when I got to Sydney in Australia, I actually met my husband and never got any further. So we stayed there for about 25 years, and then he got a job offer from Grand Valley State University. Actually, he interviewed for the job, and then he said we were coming over to do, he was doing a very short lecture tour here. And so we went to stay with my brother in Canada for Christmas, and then we knew nothing. We rented a car. This is like the day after New Year's Eve. We rented this car and we said to them, do we need snow tires or chains? And they said, no, you're not going to need that. So we drove from Vancouver right across America. And when we got to, I think we were somewhere, I actually forget, in the middle somewhere. And he had to, because the Grand Valley had been doing a search and they had gone to the American History Association conference, which happens in the first few days after New Year's Eve. And that's where a lot of interviews are conducted for jobs for various universities. And they said to my husband, call us back and see if you've made the shortlist. So we were somewhere like, I want to say Kansas. And he called up and they said, yes, we'd like to interview you. Can you be here by Friday morning? And that was, I think, Tuesday. And so we drove through, and we really didn't hit much snow until we got round the bottom of the lake from Chicago.
Yes.
And then we hit a snowstorm and drove all the way here and stayed in the hotel just here. And after the day at university, and this is the story that I tell that I don't think anybody believes this, but we had come all the way in this sedan that was like, I think it was rear wheel braking, and you know, and we'd come up over the mountains and just out of, you know, Canada, we came up over the mountains and it was snowing, and that was exciting. But when we got to Grand Valley, and at the end of the day, I was looking out the window at the office, and these people were getting these long sticks out and were scraping the ice and snow off their cars. And I said to my husband, "Oh, that's what that's for." Because we had come the whole way from Canada and had no idea. Yeah, we went out to dinner that night, and the head of the department said, "You know, well, do you think you could live in Grand Rapids?" And I'm like, "Sure." So we ended up coming back and starting in the new semester. So
wow!
But before that, we had to drive back to Vancouver, and we drove through Wyoming in a blizzard in Montana. An absolute, like, don't go on the road unless you absolutely have to, and we absolutely had to. So it was terrifying.
Oh, yeah.
So the first thing we did when we came back was we bought a car with all-wheel drive, because we thought...
Good idea.
We just are not that proficient in snow driving.
No.
So, you know. So that's it, and that was 15 years ago.
So now, how did you meet your husband?
I was living in a group house in Sydney, and there was nobody home. It was a Sunday morning, and I had been out to the beach, and it was summer, and I had come back, and I decided to make a cake. So I was making a cake in the kitchen, and the phone rang, and it was for a housemate of mine, Tina, and I said, "I'm sorry, she's not here." And then I heard the front door open downstairs, and I heard a voice, and I said, "Wait a minute, she's here." And she came running up to the phone, and behind her came this very young man with blonde hair, very cute. And he said, I said, "Hello, who are you?" And he said, "I'm Tina's flute teacher, Craig." And I said, "Hello, Tina's flute teacher, Craig. I'm Tina's flatmate, Pamela." And he didn't laugh, and I thought he had no sense of humour. But I gave him a piece of cake, and he said, "Do you want to come to the movies with us?" And that was it. But the other part of the story is that when we went to the movies, we were standing outside. There were the three of us. I don't think Tina was happy. I think this was more of a date than Craig realised. But anyway, this young Asian man attached himself to us. He was all dressed up in a suit. He said, "Look, I'm here on a conference. I've never been outside of..." I think he came from Hong Kong, although my husband would argue it was Singapore. But anyway, and he said, "I'm lonely. The conference doesn't start until tomorrow. Could I join you? And if you let me sit with you in the movies, I'll take you to dinner tonight." And we were like, okay, because we were all young, poor people, and, you know, free dinner was like, right. And he took us to a really nice steakhouse.
Oh, my.
So we all got steak. And he said, halfway through the dinner, he said, "You know, my grandmother reads palms, and she, you know, she taught me. Would you like me to read your palm?" So Craig said, "Yeah, okay." So he read Craig's palm. And I thought, wow, you know, he told him some things that I was like, wow, okay, I don't want to know that. And he said to me, "Would you like me to read your palm?" And I said, "Okay, but don't tell me anything bad." And he said, "No, okay." So he said, "Okay, let me see your hand." And then he said, "Can we talk? Can you come?" So we went over the other side of the room, and he said to me, "Are you still married?" And I said, "No, I'm divorced." And he said, "Okay, we can go back now." So he sat down and he looked at my palm and he said, "Well, you'll be very happily married for a very long time and you'll have two children." And I said, "Don't be stupid. I just met this man at lunchtime. And last month we have been married 40 years. And we have two children."
Oh my goodness. That is so much fun.
I don't know, you know.
The first night that you met him.
I know.
So he plays the flute, he's taught the flute, and then he also teaches.
Yes, he was, when I first met him, he was a professional musician, and he played in a band which was called Lionel Driftwood and the Pile Drivers, and they were supposed, he was Lionel Driftwood. And there was this old lady who played the piano. She was an actress, and she played the piano. And it was a dinner theatre show called Dimboola, which is about a wedding in outback Australia. And they serve you a really terrible chicken dinner if you're in the audience. And it's a very funny story about how the wedding goes wrong and all sorts of things. And every so often, the producer would come in to the rehearsal. They'd rehearse every so often. And he would say, Craig, you're way too in tune. I need you to pull the neck of your saxophone out and play. And he had many adventures. And interestingly enough, a lot of the actors in that show went on to become quite famous within Australia as actors. So
that's cool.
It was really interesting. Yeah, so that's what he did. And at the same time, he was going to the first ever jazz studies course at the conservatorium. So, and he's done other things as well and run school bands and stuff like that. But then he decided that he wanted to go back and finish his degree, and one thing led to another. And there were no jobs in Australia for professors. It's just, you know, it's very tight there. Mm. And so, you know, we came here where the jobs were, to Grand Rapids, which everybody in our family said, where?
Yeah, where?
Where? And his brother had said, well, if you lived in New York, I'd come and see you. But what would I come to see you in Grand Rapids? And I always say, well, the first thing I think of is me. But, you know, maybe they'll come one day. A lot of the children come. So, yeah.
So now, were you involved with teaching as well or music?
No. When I came here, and this is something I think people don't understand, I came here on a spousal visa, which means, as far as the United States of America is concerned, you do not exist. You have nothing. I could not get a book out of the library. The first thing I had to do was get my driver's license. And I remember the instructor, that because we had to have a lesson with the instructor first,
right,
and then he did the test with us. And he said, I'm sorry, but you guys will be dead within the first 3 months, because you go, when the light turns green, you both put your foot down and go straight ahead.
Yeah.
And he was like, you're going to be killed by someone running a red light, because everybody runs red lights here. So I remember that. But anyway, once I got my driver's license, I could actually get a book out of the library. Otherwise, I had to get it under my husband's name. And it was really as if I did not exist at all. So, and I suspect it's pretty much the same for anyone who comes in. My husband had an H-1B. And this is the other thing. From the moment you accept the job, you have 2 years in which to start your green card application, or you don't get one. So you have to start when we got to the university, somebody in HR came to see us and said, you have to come and sit down with me because we have to start this now. So we did, and she said, really, I would advise you to use a lawyer. And yes, it costs money, but it makes it so much easier.
Mm-hmm.
So we did that, and we left that with her, and she said, and we got our green cards, and then, of course, when I got a green card, I got a social security number. So do I remember it? No. Everybody's, how can you forget your social security number? Well, I lived the first 50-odd years of my life without one, so, you know. But anyway. And then after that, when you get your green card, you may not apply for citizenship for 4 years, or for sorry, 4 years and 9 months, because you may start 3 months before the 5 years of your green card have elapsed. And then if you do not begin it, then your green card is only good for 10 years, and after that you either have to become a citizen or you have to leave and go back to where you came from.
So you guys are citizens, I take it?
Yes, we are citizens, okay. Because we had gone for 7 years without voting, and I thought if I do one more year without at least being able to say this is what I stand for personally, I'm going to go mad. So, you know, but other reasons too. It makes it a lot easier. And so we became citizens. That's another thing. I'm a citizen of three countries. So I'm a New Zealander, an Australian, and I am an American citizen. And I cannot have any more citizenships as far as America is concerned.
Mm.
They don't care how many others you have. They only want the American citizenship to be your last one.
Oh, okay.
There you go.
I will not make my comment.
And, you know, we had to do the whole thing where you go over, and our appointment was at 7:30 in the morning in Detroit.
Mm.
So we were over there at 7:30 in the morning, and we had to be seen individually. And, you know, I get really cranky lately because sometimes I say this is not what I became a citizen for. This is not the America I became a citizen of. But anyway, but the other thing is that they really do say to you in the interview, are you prepared to bear arms for America?
Wow.
And so I had to say yes, because I was pretty sure that if I said no, I'm not going to, they might say, well, you can't become a citizen then. So
wow.
You have to be kind of careful that you actually give them the right responses. And it always makes me laugh, because they always ask you if you have belonged to any terrorist organizations. And I said to the man behind the desk, but why would anyone tell you that? And he said, because if we find that you lied about anything during this interview, that is automatic grounds for revoking your citizenship.
Hmm.
So I'm like, okay, so yeah.
So now you're not invisible anymore.
No, I'm not. But people never assume that I'm a citizen. They sort of assume that I'm just here and maybe I'm, you know, maybe I don't want to be a citizen. And people make citizenship decisions for, I mean, I have a friend who's Scottish. She won't do it. She's been here for more than half her life, and her children are American and all grown up, but she's, you know, no, she just doesn't want to do it.
So how did it feel when they didn't even consider you visible? I mean,
it was awful. I had run my own business in Australia, and I felt really invisible. I felt as though, and so the first thing we did, we were living in a colleague's house. They were on sabbatical in South America. And so we lived in their house. And after about 6 weeks, I used to go out to the university with Craig every single day, because otherwise, we only had one car and I was at home sort of like,
mm-hmm.
What'll I do? And then we bought our own car. We had been using one of the cars of the colleague. And then I said, you know, I think we have to get a dog. So I really, you know, if you're going to relocate somewhere and you're going to be there for a very long time, get yourself a dog. Because, you know, and I remember one day we bought our house in Easttown, but we didn't move in for about 4 months. And we had our next door neighbor, who's a fantastic builder, he renovated the bathroom for us. And so by the time, and I kept buying furniture, and because we brought nothing with us, two suitcases each, we sold so much stuff. We sold the house and everything in Australia, and my husband, and to this day, it is now a standing joke with us, we packed up 54 boxes to ship, and 53 of them were his books. And one of them was like some stuff I thought I'd write with me.
Wow.
But we had nothing else. And so I would go out every week and buy stuff like, you know, carving knives and placemats and just everything, right down, right. You know, from the baseboards up, everything you could think of that you needed in a house. And so gradually, we began having the furniture delivered and stuff and sort of settling into the house. And one day I was over there, I used to, you know, this was when the dog was a puppy. He was about 3 months old. And we went over there one day and two things happened. One day I accidentally sleeve locked the front door. It has a very old fashioned lock on it. You can sleeve lock it. And I went outside and I turned around and looked back in. And he was inside and I was outside and the keys were inside with him. And I'm looking through the window and he's like, hello. So I had to go next door and the neighbor's wife drove me to the building site that he was working on where he had his spare key to our house so I could go back and let myself in and rescue the dog who had curled up in a corner and gone to sleep. He was like, well, she'll be back soon, I'm sure of it. And the other thing was one day I was very, very homesick. He was about 4 months old. And I was sitting halfway up the stairs in the middle of the day and I just burst into tears. And he came over and he just sat on the stair next to me and he leaned against me like this, like, I don't really know what to do, but I'm just going to lean on you and see if that helps, you know. So we had him for 9 years and he died of cancer.
What kind of dog was he?
He was a cockapoo.
Aww.
His name was Buster, and everybody loved him. My neighbors still say, I miss that dog, and he's been gone 4 or 5 years.
Wow.
I just really adored him. I remember this man came to tune a piano that we had, and he said, that dog has the kindest eyes I've ever seen. And he was just a sweetie. And so we're going out to visit family for December and beginning of January, and we'll be back. And after that, we're going to get another dog because it's time to get another dog now. And because my husband travels a lot, so it's nice when you have a dog. It's company.
Good company.
It is, yeah. So anyway, yeah, he was a lovely dog. We taught him to compete in fly ball. Do you know what fly ball is?
Mm-mm.
Where dogs, and first of all, you have to find out if your dog is right-handed or left-handed. So they have to run, over the jumps. And everybody loved Buster because he was a small dog. He was like on the small side of medium. So they set the jumps to the smallest dog. Mm. And you have a team of four dogs. And so each dog takes a turn and jumps over four jumps and goes to a box that they hit with either their right paw or their left paw. He was right pawed. And a ball pops out when they hit it. And they take the ball in their mouth and they run back. And then they drop the ball and the next dog runs.
Wow.
And it's a team sport. It's called fly ball. And he loved it. But we had him taught to do it, and they really wanted him to join their team. But we were like, I'm afraid we did that when our children were teenagers. You know, we did all that weekend traveling to sports. No, we're not going to do that with
our
dogs.
That's so funny. I've never heard of such a thing.
It's amazing. Yeah, it was a colleague of Craig's who said, you know, I'm going to take my dog out to have him taught to be a flyball dog, and her dog failed and ours was brilliant, and we felt really bad about that, but you know, it was a lot of fun. And he got the idea very fast, very, very fast, and he was a real little rocket. He'd sort of go blip blip over the jumps.
And it's so cute.
It was cute. He was very, very cute. Aww. But yeah, so.
It's so hard.
It is. He became, you know, he became, our children were like, really, you've replaced us with a dog. And
they're a family.
I know.
They really are.
They are family. Yeah. So yeah. Anyway, so that's what happened. But coming here was, it changed my life completely.
I'll bet, because you mentioned you had a business before.
Yes, I had a travel company which designed performing art tours.
Oh, nice.
And it was for in and out of Australia.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a number of tours going out. And then I was leading a group. We went to California, and I was actually in Las Vegas and in my hotel room, and the phone rang, and it was a man called Jonathan from Purdue. And he said, I was wondering if you would do all the performances for the Purdue Varsity Glee Club when we come out to Australia, New Zealand, and Fiji. So I said, yeah, I think I can do that for you. So that was fun. So I did that. And then my husband said, can we do some special interest tours? And I said, yes, of course we can. So he is a great walker. And so he took people to New Zealand for 8 days, hiking in 5 of the national parks there.
Nice.
And then he said, can I take people to Europe on a jazz tour? And I said, yes, you can, but we don't have the money for you to go ahead, and you're going to have to set it up and do it on the ground. So he only ever did that once. And he said, I'm never doing that again.
Work.
He said it was very hard work. Some terrible things happened. And they were people who said they were jazz fans, but really just wanted to drink a lot and complained bitterly about things like, why doesn't anybody get a coat of paint put on Venice? It just needs some more paint on it to smarten it up. And why would we not have cars being allowed in the middle of Florence? And where's the McDonald's? And, you know.
Oh, my.
He was like, no, I don't think so. So
wow.
So that was fun. You never make any money, but you never go into debt if you do it right. And you get to do travel. So, yeah. So we came here, and ever since, people have said, can you just, how about if you, and you arrange, and you're like, no, I don't want to do that anymore, you know. But anyway, sometimes we do. Just, we usually help to organize a tour after an international big history conference if it's been somewhere else. And last year it was in Amsterdam, so I think it was a 9-day tour of all the big history sites in Europe. So that we went to the Hadron Collider and all that sort of stuff. It was really interesting. It was good. And we also went into Lascaux Cave, which you can't see the real cave.
Oh.
You get to see a copy of the cave next door. So.
Oh, okay.
Well,
yeah, you have to watch out about the,
you know, because then, well, they can't, yeah. They just can't, they can't even fix it.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, you know, so deteriorated from all the things that happened. There's molds and stuff that they just, when they try to remove it, they destroy, you know.
Right.
It's very difficult. So we did things like that, you know. But, you know, halfway through, we always look at each other and say, why did we think we'd do this? But, you know. Anyway, we've done some fun things. And one of the things we did last year was that I had said to my husband, he's very much a world figure now in big history, so he does a lot of travel with that. And he, you know, he records for the teaching company and the great courses, you know, and stuff like that. So he's away, and I was like, well, I'd just like to go. What I'd like to do is go and live somewhere in Europe for a couple. So we went, he had a second sabbatical, and we left on the 31st of July and came home on the, we left on the 1st of July and came home on the 31st of December. So.
Oh, wow.
And we lived We did a lot of stuff, but we lived in Berlin for a month, which was really amazing. Berlin is not what I expected. I thought it would be little cobbled streets, and I forgot that it was decimated during the war. So it's mostly been rebuilt.
Mm-hmm.
And and that was interesting because I don't know what it was like before, but now there is absolutely no hiding the Holocaust at all. And they're very matter of fact about it, and they have really incredibly detailed exhibits and things that you can go and look at, and
wow.
That, you know, they don't hide anything. And they don't make comment on it, they just lay it out there like,
mm-hmm.
This is what happened. They don't say we're terribly sorry, and they don't say we're horrified and it can never happen again. They say this is the lesson in of itself, that you look at it and you make your mind up that it can never happen again. It's very powerful. So that was interesting, but Berlin was a very interesting place to live. Very not what I expected, but I enjoyed it. It's really quite different.
So Grand Rapids, I mean, or America in general, has it changed a lot since you first got here?
Since we first got, yes. I mean, I was saying this to somebody the other day. When we first got here, you could go to Sanchez, Bistro Bella Vita, or Charlie's Crab. I live in Easttown. There would be at least 20 restaurants, excellent restaurants that I can walk to. Maybe more. It is just so different. It really is so different. And it's been fast.
Yes.
You know, it's really sort of, it surprises me. So, yeah, it has been very different. The other thing that happened for me was that not long after we moved here, and I think it was in the first 4 years, we went to Harbor Springs with some friends of ours, and we stayed in their daughter's best friend's apartment for, I think it was Memorial Day weekend. And it was lovely. And she was an artist. And she had just started doing, she did many things, and she still does many things. But she had just started taking old windows and using them as a canvas for art. And I remember my friend's husband and I both stood there, and we looked at this one that she wasn't there, that she had been making and had left on a workbench. And we both looked at each other and said, I think I can do that. And so I have been making windows ever since.
Really?
Yes. And I've been in Art Prize, so it's been running 9 years. So I've been in it 7 times now.
So you are an artist as well.
I am. And so I'm an artist, and the other thing I do is I write blog posts when I'm traveling, mostly just when I'm traveling.
Like a travel blog?
Yeah, but okay. It's sort of just sort of my idea of what. So when we're away the 6 months, I wrote every second day. Because if I didn't write every second day, I would forget what I'd done. Because we went out every day and did stuff except for 3 days in which I said, no, I'm not moving. But yeah, and so that's really good. You know, like I enjoy doing art. I've been at the Women's City Club for the last 5 years, I think, and I have exhibited my window there. And this year I made photo frame size windows just to put in. They have a gift store.
Oh, nice.
During Art Prize. And I'm a member of the Women's City Club, and I am a board member. So, and the other thing I do is I serve on two boards, two other boards. One is the Housing Appeals Board, which is a very interesting experience. People always think when they get a notice of a violation that, you know, we're going, if they protest it and want to have their case heard, that we're going to be mean to them. And we're really not mean. We try and help everybody, usually. And then the other thing is that I have been involved for many years, from the beginning, really, of the Uptown Corridor Improvement District, which is the same as the Downtown Authority. And in Uptown, which is East Town, East Hills, Wealthy Street, and East Fulton shopping centres, mm-hmm. we have the Corridor Improvement District Board, which may have a resident on it, and I'm the resident representative. And then we have the Business Improvement Board, and that's like, I always explain it by saying, if you have a Corridor Improvement Authority, they can put in the planter boxes, they can do infrastructure, and that's all they can do. Uh-huh. They can put in the planter boxes. Then you need a Business Improvement Authority to fill the boxes.
Okay. Nothing's ever easy.
No. So wow. Isn't that interesting? So, mm-hmm. and at the moment we are, I'm coming to the end of my board tenure with them. And we are also in the process of looking at, the city is assisting us to set up an Uptown nonprofit. It's called Uptown something, and I forget what. But anyway, mm-hmm. it, because we can't do it on our own, but the city can do it for us. And then that would be like an umbrella organization. And that hopefully will draw in the neighborhood associations, because funding is becoming very... limited everywhere. For them, very wow. limited. And so that would make us a very strong organization. So, and you know, of course, Uptown is hosting its annual Shop Hop on the first Thursday in December, so as it always does, which is always a bit of a riot and a lot of fun, usually with lots of entertainment on the streets, you know, singers and Santas and such.
That's neat.
So yeah, so those are the things that I do, and I am also on I help with the administration of the International Big History Association, which we founded and based at Grand Valley, so it's actually has an office there, and I am the chair of the advisory council to the board of the International Big History Association. But there is a chance my husband will become president of the association next year, in which case I cannot be chair of the advisory council anymore, because that would be nepotism and inappropriate. So that's okay. So anyway.
Sounds like you have a very full life here.
I guess I do. You know, I do stuff, and I said this to somebody recently, and I don't mean it to sound flippant, but I do things that amuse me.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I do them for as long as they amuse me. And I don't mean I'm laughing. I mean they...
Like they make you happy, maybe?
They make me happy and they engage me, and I feel useful.
Them, maybe, yeah.
Okay. And so I'm thinking, when we get this dog next year, I'm thinking that I might see if this dog is capable of being a therapy dog, because I'd really like to get involved with that.
That would be really cool.
I know. I have a friend, actually a staff person for International Big History. Her dog is 7 years old, and she got her to be a therapy dog this year. And she takes the dog to school, and the autistic children read to the dog. And I said,
oh,
what does the dog do? She said, she just sits there. I was like, you know, how do you know if the dog's listening? She said, it's not really important. But it's non-threatening to the children to be reading to the dog.
Right.
The dog is not going to make any comments about how well they read. So I was like, oh, I could do that. And she goes to nursing homes and hospitals and takes the dog there.
That's really cool.
And I thought, well, you know, you have to see if they're suitable. They have to be a certain type of dog, so.
That would leave mine out.
Well, she said, no, this is really interesting. She said, when Bianca puts her little coat on, because they get a coat to okay. say they're, mm-hmm. then she knows she's going to work.
Like a business outfit.
So she yeah. behaves herself.
That's awesome.
And she said, but when you take the coat off, she's like all over the place. Because she said, you do a lot of training and that they understand when I'm wearing the coat, I have to do as I'm told.
That is so awesome.
Isn't that interesting?
It is. It is.
So I thought, okay, I could do that. That might be interesting. So yeah, I don't know. And I'm starting to do windows that are, I do landscapes and I do trompe d'oeil, you know, with mm-hmm. the, and I love doing that. I've done little dancing people that I like doing. They're a lot of fun to do. But now I'm thinking about doing deconstructed landscapes so that I've got one at the moment that I've laid the windows out and I'm thinking about it. So the top one will be the top of the tree. The next one, which is a narrow frame, will be the trunk, and then you'll have the roots down the bottom. See how that goes.
That's cool.
So yeah.
So now, did you do art, did you make art when you were still in Australia? Or is this
no.
something that you just started when you were here?
I started it when I was here. Hmm. It was just, you know, I don't know. The one thing that I remembered years ago, my sister and I were talking, I was visiting her in New Zealand, we were talking about it, and she said, thank goodness one of the Smythe girls finally made it to America. She's 10 years older than me. She married. And they left as soon as they got married, New Zealand, and they came to America. And they had lived here for 3 years. And towards the end of the third year, when my sister, they had green cards. My sister was a nurse, and she had a high position in a hospital because New Zealand nurses were very well trained mm-hmm. at that time. And my brother-in-law was high up in hotel management, and they were going to live here forever. And my mother was dying of cancer, and my father wrote and said, come home and nurse your mother, she's dying. So she did. They came home. She said, we stayed up all night long and decided we'd come back. And she flew back, and my brother-in-law came back on a ship with all their belongings. And my mother died less than a year later, and my sister and her husband got themselves all organized to come back here to the States. And her mother-in-law, who was a widow by that time, said, you can't leave me, to Jim. Her son, she said,
oh.
You're my only son, you can't live. And so she said, we never got back, never, never. And and I realized that when I was 16, my stepmother bought me a subscription to 17 magazine because that's all I wanted. And I just wanted to be an American girl and wear plaid skirts and knee socks and, you know, well, isn't that funny? And I had forgotten about it
mm-hmm.
until years later, and I realized I finally made it.
It's funny because a lot of people here say, we want to get out of America.
I know. Everybody yeah. says, why, if you lived in Sydney, would you come and live in Grand Rapids? And mm-hmm. I'm like, well, you know, if you only ever eat chocolate ice cream in your life, you're missing out on a whole bunch of other flavors. I don't know. And, you know, we lived in Sydney for 25 years, and I like going back and visiting, I really do, but I can't live in that size city anymore. I couldn't mm-hmm. live in Chicago or Detroit. I love going to both of them.
Right.
Don't want to live there.
Mm-hmm.
There's enough traffic here now.
Yeah. Yeah, it's getting a lot bigger.
It's getting a lot worse
I know.
Than it was. But, you know, I just, and I love the sense of community. I'll never forget, many years ago, I was walking down Lake Drive in Easttown, and Jeremy Huffman, who was the community policeman for many, many years, pulled out of a driveway, wound down his window and said, "Hello, Miss Pamela, how are you today?" And I thought, oh my goodness, I really have moved to, you know, OP.
Oh, what is that? I know what you're talking about.
You know what I mean.
Yes,
I can't
I do.
I can't think of it, but I'm living there. Here I am.
I'll think of it as soon as we're done.
I know. And that was the weirdest thing, too. The first morning I woke up here after I flew in, my husband Craig was here for a month first, mm-hmm. and then I flew in, and he brought me back to the house late at night, and I woke up in the morning and I could hear people talking outside the window because it was August, and the windows were, and I thought, oh, I don't live in Australia anymore. Because when you're staying in hotels, you don't, it's not the same.
No, not at all.
You know, so yeah.
Wow.
Anyway.
Is there anything else you'd like to add that I haven't asked you?
I don't think so. I came, you know, where I lived in New Zealand was tiny. Mm-hmm. Tiny. I mean, I was on the edge of the town and there was a farm nearby.
Oh, wow.
And my mother owned the field next door to our house. And they used to, the farmers would rent it when their sheep were in lamb. And they could get in to tend to them. So we often had a lamb warming up in the kitchen, you know.
Aww, that's really cool.
Yeah, so I went from that to Auckland, which was big, and then to Sydney, which was, when I sailed in through the heads on that ship, I was like, I think I'll just turn around and go back. This is too big for me. It's really scary. And now we've come back to somewhere smaller, and I really like it. I really like it. And it's just, we have a very, our block is fantastic. Very close, all of us. And we have a lot of fun.
That's great.
So, you know. And the last thing I'd say, when we were looking to buy a house, and our realtor said, "You didn't look at any house. You haven't told me the houses you want to look at." And I was like, "Oh, it doesn't work like that in Australia. You know, in Australia, they take you around and show you the houses they have." And she said, "Oh, okay. I've chosen four for you to look at." And the first one, she said, as we drove up to it, "This one is in Easttown, because I don't know, but I kind of think you might be an Easttown sort of person." And I guess I am, and I'm still not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing.
It's a good thing. So you just bought the first house you've looked at?
Not right on the spot.
Okay.
So many people said you can't do that, because we saw four houses. I said, "Take those two out." I walked into two and said, "No, I don't mm-hmm. want them." So there were two left. We took Craig back 2 days later, and he looked at them, and he said, "This one, the first one, this is the one I want." And everybody said, "You can't buy the first house you see." And we said,
"Why not?
Why not? Why not?" And they said, "No, you'll be sorry." No, 15 years later, not sorry.
Wow, so it is the first house you looked
at. It was the first house.
That is amazing. That makes it so much easier. It takes a lot of the stress off.
And it did. It was just
awesome.
Like, and the other thing was that she said, we were standing outside, they had an open house on Sunday, and we called her up and said, "Boy, there's a lot of interest. We want to make an offer." And she said, "Okay, come over to my office." And we went, this was like 5 o'clock on a Sunday night. And she said, "You know, it's a popular house. I think you're going to have to offer them what they want." And we said, "What do they want?" And she said, $164,000. And we looked at each other. We had just sold our house in Sydney for $600,000. And we looked at each other and said, "I think we'll buy this. Thank you. Make the offer." Because we were, and that house in Sydney was the last cheap fixer-upper
Oh my word.
anywhere that we had fixed it up. We bought it for $240,000. 12 years later, we sold it for $600,000. You
Wow.
would not buy a house in Sydney for anything anywhere under $1 million.
You know what? I am so really, really happy to have met you. And I mean that sincerely. This has been really enjoyable. I just found everything you were talking about so fascinating. And I'm glad
Thank
you're
you.
happy
Yes,
here.
I am. I
Yeah.
am. It was very hard coming back from Europe last year. It was very emotionally upsetting, and it was also very hard to make. Our last 2 months, we lived in a little tiny village in the south of France, which there was no sound at all. And that when we got off the plane in Grand Rapids, I nearly went insane for about 3 days because it was so noisy. And it had been so quiet. And we had many adventures in France, and I'd love to go back and visit again. But you know, this is after the initial upheaval. 6 months is probably too long to go away, but you know, we're back here and this is my home. People say, "Are you going home, Pamela?" And I go, "No, I'm home."
That's great.
So yeah.
Thank you so much.
Oh, thank you. I've really enjoyed myself. Yeah, thank you.